As bishop in Eastern South Dakota, I've been so very blessed to be here. Certainly have been some extraordinary times. The thing that's certainly been stirring in my heart, and I got even more clarity today, is just the impact that COVID has had. Certainly on all of those who've been ill, those who've died, who've been hospitalized, all those who are caring for them. But also, of course, all the measures that were put in place to do whatever we could to protect the vulnerable. Even as bishop, I made the decision to dispense from the obligation of Sunday Mass because of the predictions of what it might be and the profound impact that it could have on those who are vulnerable. Well, thanks be to God. What was anticipated has not been as bad as what was anticipated. Not that it's not serious for some, because it has been. We can look at the deaths, for example, and as I mentioned, the hospitalizations. But the number of hospitalizations were not as severe, for example, as what we originally had been projected and anticipated. We're so blessed here in our own state to try to find that reasonable balance between one extreme of saying it's not a big issue and on the other extreme being overly concerned. How do we find that balance? Obviously, we look for truth in all of this, and the truth sometimes is hard to find because we're looking for facts. Well, we're blessed now to see how this COVID has transpired. We're able to look at data to try to get a better understanding of the impact that it's had, at least from the physical standpoint of things. One of the areas that's more difficult and I want to speak in today is the emotional impact, or if you will, the psychological impact. What happens to us when we're inundated with all this information, all this uncertainty, all the things as we look around the country and even around the world of the measures that have been taken and how people are changing things. For example, business and the restrictions in different states and all those kinds of things. Obviously, there's huge impact financially as an example, and that can also be monitored or determined by looking at data. The emotional impact on a person sometimes is not as public. We ourselves, in that isolation, that separation, that pulling back, we can be dealing with things interiorly. And sometimes those interior things, we don't know what to do with them. My encouragement for us is to look at the facts that we do have, as we continue to get more information, because it can help us to be reasonable in our judgment. So we're not underestimating, we're not overestimating. We're looking, as St. Thomas Aquinas says, the virtue or the good habit is in the middle. That's where facts come in and be really helpful. We have to remember, as human beings, we're social beings, which means we want to be with people, we want to interact, we want healthy, normal relationships, which helps us to be healthy, happy, and holy. There are times, of course, where we need to isolate, we need to separate. Social distancing, for example, or those who need to be in quarantine. That's hard to go through those because it's not normal. We're not wired that way psychologically. Those things can impact us. And as a consequence, they can leave us in a certain vulnerable place where we have lots of uncertainty, perhaps even more fear than what's reasonable fear. If fear is not rightly balanced, what these sort of things can do, the emotional impact it can have on us, can leave us even with things on a very extreme level with what they call post-traumatic stress syndrome. Something easily triggers. The fear is above and beyond what's reasonable in the particular situation. So the hope is we can continue to reach out to others, help us sort this out, get good advice from those who are close to us, the professionals who can help us. But I also want to address the spiritual impact that this virus has had, continues to have to some extent. Not only are we naturally wired, if you will, emotionally to be social beings, we're wired to be in close spiritual relationship, not only with God, but with others. For example, when we celebrate Holy Mass, the Mass is intended to be that place where we as a community of faith worship God as a community. And that experience can't be replaced by anything else. Receiving the body and blood of Jesus, as I taught when we were not able to have Masses, I suspended them because of the seriousness that it was looking like. In that suspension, realizing that was a prudent thing to do then. So now the question is it still the right time? How do we find our way back to church? How do we find those normal, healthy, interactive relationships, not just socially, but spiritually? For those of us who are in the healthier stages of life or not in those areas of vulnerability, obviously it's very different than those who are. And so we need to each prudently discern before God do I have a legitimate reason for not being at Mass? There are some that are, absolutely. And so we encourage people to pray, to discern, because we need to keep moving back towards what's normal, what's healthy. The further we stay back from it, the more we can be apprehensive and the harder it can be to get back to what is a healthy balance of life, emotionally, spiritually, even in our social interactions. Just know of my prayers as you continue to discern, as you pray, but for us to really try to be objective as we can, and then to turn to God and ask for the spiritual insight to know in our own conscience, Lord, how is it you want me to sort this out in my own life as it relates to my spiritual opportunities, not just Mass, but other spiritual things that I do, not only personally, but communally. And what is it that you desire? So we can find that integration, that settling of peace. God's got this one. And we know that love casts out all fear. And when we live in God, we live in truth and we're not afraid because God is our strength and He leads us and guides us. Know my prayers for you and what's on my heart this very day. God bless you. Until next time.